Subscribe to WROK on YouTube and never miss a meeting.
I think we have all the members of the City Commission that we're going to have here tonight. Before we begin, I'll just note that Commissioner Macy and Commissioner Dubuck are doing their duty right now in Washington, D.C., representing our city by chaperoning hundreds of eighth graders on their trip. So I'm sure they're doing us proud. They can't wait to get back, I imagine. And we should all say a little prayer for them that they keep their sanity. And they rode the bus down with them. So, yep, better parents than me. All right, so I'm going to call to order the Monday, May 8, 2023 Royal Oak City Commission meeting to order. We're going to begin with an invocation given by Commissioner Colo, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. I ask that you stand if you can, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As we come here today, we are reminded of the power of community and the strength of our shared values. We stand united in our commitment to justice, equity, and peace. Today, May 8th, marks the 78th anniversary of the Nazi surrender to the Allied forces in Europe. After many years and far, far too many lives lost, World War II would soon come to an end. On this day, we honor the bravery and sacrifice of those who fought for our freedoms and democracy. We honor their memory by continuing to build a society that upholds the values they fought and died for. Unfortunately, there are still some in this world filled with hate, filled with vitriol, and a poison in their character. There are some who seem to forget that the world stood up to and fought against Nazis, and the Nazis lost. Last week, the Woodward Shaw, a Jewish house of worship in our community, was faced with a swastika. I'm thankful to our police and our DPS that responded at once, with DPS removing the swastika before the Sabbath on Saturday, and our police working swiftly with federal and local agencies to ensure that the suspect was captured. But at times of hate, it's important that we are vocal in our rejection of all hate in all forms. So despite recent actions like this and intolerance in our community, we know that love and understanding will always triumph over hatred and division. We stand together, shoulder to shoulder, in our commitment to creating a world where every person is valued and respected. Because in our community, we believe that diversity is a strength. We are a welcoming community that values inclusion, respects dignity of every person, regardless of their backgrounds or beliefs. So, in the midst of the hardship, we are reminded that joy cometh in the morning. Even when we face darkness and despair, we can take heart in the fact that the dawn will come and bring with it new hope and new possibilities. So I'll close with this tonight. Two commissioners are missing from this table. They are leading a group of over 250 middle schoolers on a trip to DC. They will learn about our nation's history. They will walk the halls where laws are made, and they will come back with better understanding of our past. I know these youth will come home inspired. I know they will come home curious, and that curiosity is what leads to great change. So may we continue to lift up one another, to inspire one another with our compassion and our generosity of spirit. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you, Commissioner Colo. That brings us to item four, the approval of the agenda. Commissioner Colo.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to move approval of the agenda with the amendment of moving item six to the consent agenda.
Okay. Moving item six to the consent agenda.
And that's an item that will have a troop of Girl Scouts here for in 2 weeks to receive a proclamation. So
okay,
just want to get it going, and they're eager to be here.
Very good. Any other seconds to that motion?
I'll second.
Second by Commissioner Perush. All right. Discussion on the motion. All right. With none, I'll call for the vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Motion passes. We have an agenda. All right. Which brings us to item five, which is a proclamation designation May 21st to 27th as 2023 National Public Works Week in Royal Oak. And I have a proclamation here. to offer up. And I think we have Mr. X and Mr. Fidelli here tonight. And for those of you who don't know, I think we have the most outstanding BPS team in all of the state. They're the unsung heroes of the community. They don't get the credit and attention they deserve. We just take for granted that our water will work, our toilets will flush, our parks will get mowed, our trees will get trimmed, our arborists will determine the health of the trees, things get moved around, roadblocks go up, roadblocks come down. They work tirelessly plowing the roads during snowstorms. They're a 24-hour, four-season-a-year team, multi-skilled, multi-tasked, and we're just so incredibly grateful for the team that we have in place because they literally make the city run. And I think when the bar is everything should work perfectly, that's the minimum expectation. These guys have the highest bar in the city to live up to, and they do it without complaining. They do it with a lot of fun and always with a smile on their face. So this is really a privilege to read this. I know not everybody could be here tonight because probably rest and recuperation is always important, but thank you guys for receiving this on their behalf. So whereas public works professionals focus on infrastructure, facilities, and services that are vital importance to sustainable and resilient communities and to the public health, high quality of life, and well-being of the people of Royal Oak. And whereas these infrastructure, facilities, and services could not be provided without the dedicated efforts of the public works professionals who are operators, engineers, managers, and employees at all levels of our government and private sector, who are responsible for rebuilding, improving, and protecting our city's transportation, water supply, water treatment, and solid waste systems, public buildings, and other structures and facilities essential for our citizens. And whereas it is in the public interest for the citizens, civic leaders, and children of Royal Oak to gain knowledge and to maintain an ongoing interest in the understanding of the importance of public works and public works programs in their respective communities. And whereas the year 2023 marks the 63rd annual National Public Works Week sponsored by the American Public Works Association. Now therefore be it resolved, I, Mayor Fournier, and the members of the Royal Oak City Commission hereby proclaim May 21st to the 27th, 2023 as Public Works Week in the City of Royal Oak and urge all citizens to recognize the substantial contributions these individuals make to protect the health, safety, and quality of life. And I'll present this to you, John. Thank you. Mr. Exley.
Thank you, Mayor and City Council. I would like to acknowledge some of our DPS employees that are here in the crowd. If they stand up when I call your name, Matt Began, Jay Goodnight, and Drew Glosh. And to echo the mayor's words, I mean, these guys are the nucleus of the city. And although I'm accepting this on behalf, their work really is the forefront of what we do for the city. And I applaud their work and all their efforts. And thank you.
Thank you. Can I say? I can't
see you guys back there. I got my secondary last time. My primary one's broke. Thanks, me.
Whereas Commissioner DeBuck calls them my serial killer glasses. I don't know where he gets that from, but
they were safety rated a number of years ago. Yeah. Well, the prescription is a little
weak. Let me see.
All right. Well, we're already at public comment. So, before we start public comment, I'll just read the rules once again. The City Commission values and relies on the input of our fellow citizens to help make decisions. Now is the time set aside for the public to address the City Commission on any city-related issue, whether or not it's on the agenda. I ask that comments be directed to the City Commission as a whole and not to individual commissioners. If you wish to speak tonight, please wait to recognize by me, the mayor, then come up to the podium. For the record, you'll have to state your name and address. Please be mindful, we want to hear from anyone who wishes to speak tonight. So comments are limited to 3 minutes or less per speaker, not per topic. There's a timer at the podium to help you keep track of your time. If you don't wish to speak tonight at public comment, you know, feel free to reach out to us via email. That's typically the best way to reach out to us, especially on agenda topics. If you see the agenda come out the week before, you know, email us over the weekend. It's very helpful. Please note the City Commission will not respond directly to questions during public comment. However, we're writing those questions down when the topic comes up. We try to do our best job to make sure we ask those questions to staff. And if your question is not, or your issue isn't on the agenda tonight, our city manager is taking notes and we follow up accordingly. So with that, who's first tonight? Tom.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My name is Tom Todweiler. I live at 1018 Longfellow. I am here representing the Royal Oak Historical Society. I would like to announce to everyone on the dais and to the public that we will be hosting a community pancake breakfast on Monday, May 29th, Memorial Day, at the Farmers Market. And we'd love to see you all there. The cost of it is $8 for adults and $3 for children 10 years of age and under. We are really promoting this as a community event to come and meet family, meet friends, and make new friends. So I hope I can see everybody there. And just want to mention to Police Chief Moore, your staff is welcome to come over, slide over if they can get a few minutes away. In uniform, it's on us. So, and veterans in uniform are also eat free on Memorial Day. So I want to thank you for that. I do have a couple other things, seeing as I have a little bit of time. As Commissioner Colo mentioned that two commissioners are away learning about history, it relates to what we do at the Historical Society. We are Royal Oak's keeper of history. We are the orators, so to speak, of Royal Oak's history. And I'd love to see everybody stop by sometime. And we are open from 1 to 4 on Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturdays. If you want to learn about your city's history, whether you grew up here or just moved here, it's a great place to visit. It is a remarkable museum. Second of all, they say timing is everything in life, and I know a proclamation was made to the DPS for their outstanding work. Well, I just happen to be a city employee myself also. I work for the animal shelter, and we have relied on the DPS numerous times in the time that I've been employed there. As you all probably know, we work in an old, old building that needs a lot of Band-Aids, and hopefully we'll be in a new building within the next year. But I do want to extend a thank you to them for their help for us. And last but not least, our generous sponsors for our pancake breakfast, the Holiday Market in the Royal Oak Downtown Development Authority. We couldn't do this without them, and it is much appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Yes, ma'am.
Good evening. I'm not sure if everyone received my email, but I'm representing the Parks, Recreation, and Senior Services Advisory Board. I sent an email recently regarding the funds and talking about the budget. And so if you aren't familiar with the email, I can just read it to you, and then we, if that's easier. Or if you have
questions. I read it, but if you want to read it again, that's okay.
Okay. I said, as the Parks, Recreation, and Senior Services Advisory Board Chair, I'm contacting you to request additional funds be earmarked in the next year's budget for park projects, such as park benches, picnic tables, ADA nature trails, baseball, and field materials. The advisory board met last night and was pleased to was pleased to see the list of projects that was included in the budget this year, and we talked about how to make sure that the residents can see the impact of the two millages that they passed this year, supporting both parks and our seniors. We believe that these very visible parks projects they listed above demonstrate the city's commitment to the parks, and we are in a way to thank the residents for their support in passing the millages. It is my understanding that the parks millage covers the $1.5 million cost of parks and recreation operational costs that was previously covered by the general fund. As the operational costs are now being covered by the millage, the board and I feel very strongly that the general fund should continue to be earmarked for park projects, as we promised when talking about the millage. In addition, we consider what would be considered visible signs for the senior millage as suggested by Commissioner Perucci in the budget meeting. At that moment, the budget only is spending senior millage money on senior services, nothing from the general fund. A really nice overlap for both millages would be park-related pieces that are also part of our aging-in-place plan, like the park benches, picnic tables, and ADA nature trails. This would serve to make Royal Oak more accessible to all ages and abilities. Looking at the associated cost at all of these, we are requesting an additional $200,000 be earmarked towards the important and visible projects as a reflection of the work being done with the millage dollars approved by the Royal Oak voters. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Gettinger. Mr. Harrison.
Thank you, Mayor. Bill Harrison, 2729 Trafford, Royal Oak. I understand that you're countering the no to rezoning signs by claiming that the master plan outcome is not predetermined. We have listened to you for 2 years talking about urbanization, the missing middle in housing, accessory dwelling units, and affordable housing without defining what that means. Every consultant that you interviewed supported urbanization. The selected consultants pushed the elimination of single-family zoning in Holland, Michigan. Their Birmingham, Michigan final master plan continues to push accessory dwelling units for further study. Page 36 of their summary report mentions the 15-minute city, a concept proposed worldwide by devout communist Klaus Schwab. The city manager alluded to zoning changes during the budget meetings when justifying the request for a management analyst to assist with Human Rights Commission, sustainability, aging in place, and special projects as needed. I am concerned to hear that the charrettes will include a group of stakeholders in addition to the consultants. This is the same approach that you used for Centennial Park. The concern is that these stakeholders will be supportive of your agenda. Will these meetings be charrettes or charades? I'm further concerned that the residents at large do not realize that they will not have the opportunity to vote on the master plan. Speaking of the Human Rights Commission, I have no objection to the ordinance. Laura, when running for her third term as a commissioner, actually campaigned on creating a human rights ordinance, and I have rented to both lesbians and gays. Why do we need a Human Rights Commission in addition to the human rights ordinance, given that there have not been any violations of the ordinance? I am concerned about the possibility of the misuse of power. And of course, power is your word, not mine. Joseph Stalin once said, show me the man and I will show you the crime. Thank you.
All right, who's next?
We'll go in the back.
Good evening, my name is Ellen Gendler. I live at 910 East Windermere, and this is my first ever public comment, so I hope you'll be patient with me. I am here today to speak, hopefully not too late, on the rezoning of 718 West 4th Street. I just recently began seeing signs in my neighborhood against the matter, and I looked into it. I was disappointed to learn that my neighbors are against the rezoning. This may be shocking, as I am a youth, and normally, we are in favor of preserving our property values. However, my introduction to zoning laws came when I was a young lawyer representing low-income tenants in the San Francisco Bay Area. You may be familiar with the housing crisis that has been going on there for years. The biggest issue facing my clients was a complete inability to find housing. Creating opportunities for multifamily housing and increased density is crucial for us to have a sustainable, growth-focused community moving forward. As Commissioner Colo said in his poignant invocation, diversity is our strength. That includes diversity of housing and income levels. Zoning laws, in fact, have been characterized as the replacement for racial redlining. And I think that history is important as we consider zoning and rezoning proposals. Additionally, the city's master plan calls for providing a balanced residential environment and with an eye towards sustainability, and multifamily higher density housing is key to those goals. Multifamily housing conserves energy resources in multiple ways, from sharing walls to conserve gas and heat, to creating closer access to the businesses downtown, conserving transportation energy resources, not to mention the reuse of an existing building, which conserves building resources and the energy required to create them. Modern problems require modern solutions, and increasing density in the area is a modern, sensible solution. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Denham. Yes, sir, in the aisle. Yep.
Wow, first time, long time listener here tonight, first time caller. My name is Joseph Fisher. I live at 310 West 6th Street, otherwise known as the Aldor. I don't know why we have the in front of all these names. I know we can't say what the buildings look like, but city attorney, if we can maybe not have any more buildings named the, that would be great. So I'm here tonight to talk about something that kind of occurred to me while I was driving by the Royal Oak Golf Course. And I was thinking that since, you know, we've done this, we've renamed a street for Glenn Fry, and in working on a piece of my art, I learned that he was an avid golfer. And I'd have to assume that if he was an avid golfer and he did that as a teen, he at one point played a public courses here in Royal Oak. And I think that would be a perfect example of something we could rename again for Glenn Fry. It's really easy to do. I can't think of anything less controversial. It's good publicity for the city, and maybe some real rock and roll fans might want to play the links, thinking that Glenn Fry played there once. Talked to Mr. Spadafore. He thought it was a good idea, and he thought the best conduit to suggest it was to you guys. I appreciate your time. Normally on Monday nights, I go to New Way Bar to do open mic. Since I stopped drinking, I come here, and it's better because at New Way, I have to listen to a bunch of crazy people for 2 hours before I get my turn, and here I only have to do it for 10 minutes. So I really appreciate it. Have a good night, everyone.
Hey, nice shirt.
Thank you.
All right. Anybody else here tonight for public comment? Yeah, we'll go with you, sir.
My name is Chris Meister. I live on Vincetta Boulevard. And I see that later on in the agenda tonight, you'll be voting on the United Way of Southeastern Michigan's 21-day equity program. And I checked it out, and on day three, the subject that will be addressed is what is privilege? And it is defined on their website as, within the United States, members of social groups hold privileges that historically have held dominance of power over targeted peoples. And I hope that the participants in this program, if it is approved tonight, will consider the recent history of privilege enjoyed by the developers who donate to certain political campaigns over the property rights of lowly residents and taxpayers here in Royal Oak. These people moved to Royal Oak because they liked it the way they found it, not as they hope that some future commissioner would want to change it to. And when pursuing making Royal Oak a more affordable place to live, which apparently is one of the goals of the rezoning agenda, I'd like to hope that this group will consider the possibility of making Royal Oak more affordable by operating within reasonable budgets and passing tax lowering of tax rates onto the residents. Thank you.
Who's next? We'll go within the blue.
Good Thank you, Mayor. My name is Chad Herbert. I live at 1031 Oak Ridge. And what I wanted to address the council tonight about was the construction work that's being done on Vincetta Boulevard. It appears to me that the choice of the bump outs and the curbing has been, from my view and a lot of the views of other residents, unilateral. I don't have much opinion on what goes on in the downtown area where the buildings are tall, but I'm of the opinion that in neighborhoods and residential areas where we live, it should be up to us how our cities, our communities, our homes, our blocks look, feel, and work. After speaking with a couple of neighbors unofficially, just casually, seemed to be somewhat of a consensus developing that most people are not happy with the bump outs. For that reason, I started knocking on doors. I put together a little petition. I've had very little time in on this, approximately 6 hours of door knocking spread out over 2.5 days. I accumulated 40 signatures for people that are very unhappy about the bump outs. There was 6 to 7 fence sitters, indifferent. Two of those, I suggested that they don't sign the petition, and the reason for that was they hadn't walked down and seen what the bump outs looked like. I said, well, if you don't see them, I don't see how you can have an opinion either way, so don't sign the petition. Two people liked them very much. One of them happened to be Commissioner Perouche, which I didn't know she resided at that residence that I knocked on.
Surprise.
But if you do the math, completely objective, from the signatures I obtained, it worked out in the parking lot in the truck to 83% disapproval rating on the bump outs. Now I propose that this is gonna cause a problem for stuff like emergency services. I don't think you're gonna get the E1 down around these bump outs. The snow plowing is gonna be difficult. I'm a contractor. It might prove a little difficult for me to service these beautiful homes in the area in which I live. If anybody wanted to bring a camper or a boat home to get it ready for vacation, that might be out. Again, it comes down to fiduciary responsibility and being good stewards of our money. And I was told about a 7-person focus group that decided this. Who was on the focus group? We don't know. Okay. So we'd like something done about this before it gets paved in and the ship is sailed.
Thank you, Mr. Herbert.
Thank you.
All right, who's next? We'll go with Ms. Wagman in the back.
Janice Wagman. First of all, I wanted to talk about the historical museum. It is a gem. When I was on the memorabilia committee for my class reunion, that was the first time I'd been there, and it is just loaded with stuff. So if anybody's interested in Royal Oak history, they have books of tribunes, old tribunes that you can go through and get a real up close look. Anything you want to know, I mean, they've got it there, and it's awesome. Old yearbooks, old newspapers, old you name it, it's there. So definitely go visit the museum. Second of all, I want to support the Parks and Recreation Committee, Parks and Rec and Senior Committee on the extra funds, which really aren't extra because we voted in a millage, and the millage should have paid for more things, not business as usual. So what Sarah said, I'm fully in support of. The other thing is, 6 years ago, I came before this commission and asked for a senior advisory committee, a standalone, separate from the Parks and Rec senior advisory committee. In response, you did a senior task force. Commissioner Douglas, support was your delegate to that committee. They spent 5 years putting it together, put together an awesome plan. The senior task force, sundowned, and nothing has happened since. I want to see that commission, that board, that senior advisory board, reinstate or created. There used to be one many years ago, and start working on the senior aging in place plan. Get busy on it. You don't need to wait. We should get the advisory board, the appointments board, busy, and get some people appointed and hit the ground running with this. We've got a lot of stuff that could be done for the seniors in the city. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Wrightman. Okay, who's next? Yes, ma'am.
Nancy Poprovsky, 11119 Batavia. Thank you for listening. One reason I moved to Royal Oak almost 40 years ago was for the city of trees. Unfortunately, my neighborhood alone has lost more than 70 mature trees just in one small section due to development. DTE also came in to trim and take down more trees. They left a notice saying they might be on your block to trim, but with no specific time. One morning at 8 a.m. without notice, a DTE worker knocked at my door about tree trimming. I lucked out because I could be home all day, but many of my neighbors could not, and in some cases, my neighbors came home with a beloved tree totally hacked without notice. It was shocking. First of all, it's not healthy to trim a tree in 90 plus degree weather, which it was, and a tree can go into shock and are more susceptible to disease. DTE's mission was not to save or properly trim any trees. I quote from a worker, "We can't be coming back all the time to trim trees. It costs too much money, and if we cut them way back, we can wait years." So that's what they did to a neighbor who wasn't home. They cut their tree way back, so far that it had turned into the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Now it has a bigger chance of falling towards their house due to DTE's hacking the branches too far away from the lines. What sense did that make? It wasn't the workers' fault. That's what they were instructed to do. The workers in my yard were respectful, with good results, because I was there. Many other neighbors had hack jobs also, and you can see this throughout the city. Unfortunately, the cost of tree trimming or taking down a dead tree usually ranges between $2,000 to $5,000. Believe me, I know. I've done major tree trimming to my majestic mature tree 5 times in 20 years. I can't afford it anymore. I don't think many people can. That's why I'm asking you to look into what Detroit is implementing. An $8 million tree cleanup for homeowners. Priority was given to seniors, residents with disabilities, veterans, etc. A city council member remarked he had waited so long to trim a big tree, he ended up paying $7,000. An arborist with Detroit's General Service added, and I quote, "Detroit was known as the city of trees. We had a really aggressive tree care and maintenance program with crews that all they did was care, keyword care, for trees. Then that disappeared. It's come back to Detroit. Could Royal Oak work this into a master city tree maintenance plan? Royal Oak, the city of trees, can come back for its residents and mature trees. Great idea, Detroit. And I also want to thank you for the Senior Roses program. I use it, and it's tremendous. Thank you."
Thank you, Ms. Brodsky. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Good evening. Kathy Reed, you're 1403 Smith Avenue, Royal Oak, Michigan. I want to just say that I don't understand global budget, and I don't understand, in the academy thing, duties and power instead of duties and responsibilities, because the power belongs to the people. With your help, we get things done. Another thing is, in the Today book, it said, sometimes the master plan process can bring unfounded rumors. So we encourage residents to sign up and contribute to this and stay informed. Well, I think maybe we should, if you can possibly say to the public in a meeting what the unfounded rumors are.
We were fighting against when we were doing the marijuana thing, I read from the book, and it said, the annual federal survey on drugs use and mental health offers more evidence that the cannabis is now leading to increase in mental illness significant enough to be seen in the national level. Now, I know people, I've never smoked marijuana, and by the way, Glenn Frey was great. You know, it's just in our, it was approved, but we put it in our neighborhoods. So I read from the book, and I also, it said in the book that to tell your friends and family members and your mayors and legislatures, write to news outlets, raise your hand at a city council meeting, and give the true voice. I gave a book to the commission. I gave it to Judy David, or I gave it to the clerk. And I kept one to the clerk, just for you guys to look through. Because once somebody said, I don't really care about marijuana, I don't really know what it does. Okay, so I gave the book just to peruse it. I haven't read the book, I read the facts. You can open a book and find out all kinds of things that have happened to families. And like I say, it's just in our neighborhoods, that's the bad thing. So, I gave the book, and then I called the library just to make sure they got it. After they voted on the marijuana in the three places, the clerk called me and said, do you want your book back? I said, no, I don't need the book back, I have one. And so I said, can you give it to this high school? She said, no. She said, how about the library? I said, that would be fantastic. Called before I came to a meeting here, and the book never got to the library. It was totally verified. I don't know what happened to the book that you guys could have looked at, but I wasn't told the truth. Okay, the other thing I want to say is our children need to have a youth that they can play and enjoy. They're going to be the innovators. They're the ones that are going to do the health of climate change. If you stifle them with this kind of stuff, let them be kids, be the adults, teach them certain things, but don't let them be scared that the world's going to end tomorrow. Teach them that they can change the world. Open their minds to science and math and reading. That's all I have to say.
Thank you.
Thank you for your work. I hope you check your conscience.
All right. Does anybody else here wish to speak at public comment tonight?
Oh, thanks.
Going once. Going twice. Okay, we're going to close public comment and bring the meeting to this side of the table, which brings us to item 8, which is the consent agenda. Does anyone wish to pull anything off the consent agenda tonight? Commissioner Perush.
Let me see what number it is. Letter I, very quickly, very short.
Okay, I. Anybody else? Commissioner Colo?
J, please.
J? Okay. Anybody else? Commissioner Douglas.
I'll move approval of the consent agenda as revised.
Okay. Is there a second? Second by Commissioner Colo. Discussion? All right. With none, I'll call for the vote. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? Motion passes. We'll start with aye. Commission for the Arts recommendation of public art, Crawford Cosmetics Spa mural. Commissioner Perush.
Just a reminder, this is approval of a new mural in the city's mural program located in a new business at 118 North Washington. It's a gorgeous, gorgeous mural, if you have seen the pictures of it. Just a reminder that the Commission for the Arts is encouraging local businesses to put murals on their walls that are exposed to, on either side. It has to come before the City Commission for the Arts because we have to make the determination that it is art and not a sign. It can't be advertising for the business. It can't suggest what kind of a business it is. It has to be truly art. But we are seeing more and more of them in the community. We love them. They're a great addition, not only to the downtown, but to other commercial areas in the city along Woodward and North Washington in this location. So if anybody's interested, they can contact the city and get more information or look up the information on the Commission for the Arts page on the city website and submit an application. It's a free application, and we'll consider it, and then you can get your painters lined up. So that's it.
Is that a motion?
To approve?
Yes, I will move approval.
Okay, we have a motion by Commissioner Perush. Is there a second? Second by Commissioner Douglas. All right, discussion? I'll just say excellent points, Commissioner Perush. Thank you for advocating for art in the community and all your service towards that end. Thank you. All right, I'll call. call for the vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Motion passes. All right, this brings us to J, formerly on the consent agenda, Commissioner Colo.
Thank you, Ms. Mayor. I just, you know, going through this, there's a couple options within the proposal here. I thought we should discuss them a little as a group. So this is the city manager's review. I'm fine moving forward with Governor Char since it's a three-year process with them, which is more than understandable. I just want to advocate that we move forward with having staff evaluation. It's important that we all know what we think. I think what everyone, you know, some other city hall employees think. That helps us make our best determination. It's also what we did last year. So I want to continue on that past practice. So I'd want to look for input from, you know, department heads and maybe those like directly below them. So that's, you know, that, you know, like a DPS, it would be Aaron Flipsky and then John Fidelli. That might seem to be the best way to go about this. So I guess I'll start with that.
Okay. Responses? Commissioner Douglas?
Yeah, I agree, although I would say rather than trying to articulate what levels of staffing are included, we use the same people who or the same titles that mm-hmm. we used last year just for consistency's sake.
Sure.
Anybody else?
And then, you know, one thing that maybe to coordinate this might be best, you know, instead of asking Mr. Brake to try to manage all this, you know, it might be better or looking to the Director of Human Resources, who is someone he manages, maybe there should be two commissioners that have an ad hoc committee that just work on this, you know, work with GovHR to facilitate this.
It's not a terrible idea. Thoughts?
Are you volunteering?
And I see Commissioner Mason DeBucker gone, so when I look at two people who need to do something,
it's not fair.
But I mean, what I hear you saying, Commissioner Colo, is first, like, yes, let's go with GovHR and move forward like we did last time for the evaluation, like our evaluation of the city manager. Mm-hmm. It's a little awkward, you're sitting here right next to us, Mr. Brake. And that, similar to last year, we do the same, like, 360 feedback where we get, you know, the same list according to what Commissioner Douglas suggested, just so we can see, you know, apples to apples, what that looks like. I mean, obviously some people come and go, but, you know, there's, you know, consistency there. And you're saying instead of having GovHR do that part, that would be done by our director of HR with the support of two commissioners to kind of help oversee that activity at an ad hoc committee?
No, I'm sorry. GovHR would do that, just communicate with two of the commission members.
As advisors.
As advisors, correct. As opposed to going through HR.
Okay. Okay. Thoughts?
So, can I speak up? Good evening, Mayor and City Commissioners. So, last year, GovHR didn't have any contact with HR. They had a finished product, and they just came to the meeting and to present that. So, which is fine. But if you want to, I would suggest that the Mayor appoints who those two commissioners are, if you do want to have such an ad hoc committee. So, one other item that I'd point out to you for next year is one of my professional certifications. I am a ICMA credential manager. And on a 5-year cycle, ICMA has a very extensive 360 evaluation, not to diminish what GovHR does. But I will be asking staff to fill that out. And it's a requirement that I have for to maintain that credentialing. So we don't need to duplicate that and torment the staff with filling out two different evaluations, but I just wanted to make you aware of that. And it's helpful for me in professional growth and channeling what sort of continuing ed and professional development that's associated with that. But I just mentioned that kind of for what that's worth as a side. But again, I just wanted to clarify that GovHR, they let me know when the information's ready. I'm seeing it for the very first time. Along with you, but if there's a couple of people that want to vet it beforehand, welcome that opportunity. So that's all I want to add. Thank you.
This is an auction. Any movement counts as a bid. Commissioner, how will you answer this? So maybe instead of a committee, because this question is for Mr. Liao, a committee drives like a certain, a lot of, I'd say formalities. Do you think it'd be better to have like liaisons that are just kind of, the ones kind of nominated to talk to GovHR, and that, when those questions and things obviously come before the body, we talk about it and vote on it. But I don't know if there's a difference there. I think what Commissioner Cole was saying is like, hey, just have a little bit of commission, input, so everything, goes smoothly when the questions are asked and we don't have any hiccups, which I think is a fair suggestion. I mean, we all work independently in our passions. Is that acceptable, you think?
I think so.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Commissioner Cole?
Okay, so I will move approval of year two with GovHR with anonymous staff input, and GovHR to liaise with two commission members as directed by the mayor.
Oh, wonderful. All this power. Someone asked a question about power. These are the powers. Get to ruin someone's Thursday night. All right. Okay, a motion by Commissioner Cola. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Douglas. All right. Discussion. Commissioner Cola.
And I just want to add, I think this is just picking up on last year, how the process went, and some minor tweaks just to make sure it's smooth, but this is in no way my feelings on the city manager or how the performances are. Just want to make sure that this is just easy for everyone.
Yeah, I think it's good. I mean, I get because where we're at right now and the simplicity, although now I think about it, you don't want to have that feedback loop and then kind of just not have it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I think that it's one of those things hard to kind of, but I also understand with the ICMA, mm-hmm. You might have some overlap here, but it'll be good. I just recommend that, GovHR and liaisons keep it simple. You know what I mean? When you ask like 30 things, you really don't learn anything. If you ask for 3 things, you learn a lot. So
tell Kyle and Melanie that.
All right. Okay, I guess we have a motion on the table. I'll call for the vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Motion passes. Aye. All right. Mr. Lair, maybe just an administrative question here. I can notify, I don't think this body would, if they're just mayoral appointments, I'll just talk to the commissioner, see which ones are interested in doing it, and then I'll just let them know they're the liaison, and that should be, it's not a formal
exactly position.
Yeah,
no, that's
so
fine.
So I'll see what sort of horse trading we can do. All right. Well, that brings us to item 9 tonight, which is request to schedule review of new sidewalks 2023 sidewalk improvement and program. And city engineer Donahue is here with us tonight.
Yes, good evening.
Yeah, thanks for
having me. So as part of our sidewalk program, each year we look within the whatever target area that we're working in to evaluate if there are any locations where there currently is not sidewalk to see if installation of new sidewalks is warranted. And the overall goal there is to provide continuous sidewalks that link neighborhoods, schools, and community facilities to create a highly walkable city. So this year's target area is roughly in the southwest corner of the city, and there's only 3 locations that we're looking at for potentially installing new sidewalk. The first 2 are right along the railroad right-of-way, and those are on Forestdale and on Hilldale. And then the 3rd location is on East 3rd Street, right behind the CVS, so between Phillips and Knowles Place. So as in the past, it's pretty simple tonight. I'm just requesting that we set the following meeting of May 22nd as the meeting to determine if you do want to direct new sidewalks to be installed at any of those 3 locations. That will give you a chance to go look at them if you'd like to, mm-hmm. or hopefully the report is thorough enough if you don't have time to do that. And also gives us a chance to make sure that we notify the potentially affected property owners of that meeting. So like I said, tonight is just a resolution to simply set the date of May 22nd to make that final determination.
Wonderful. I can't imagine there's questions for City Engineer Donahue on this one. Any questions?
Give me enough time.
Commissioner Perush?
I'll move approval of the resolution setting the May 22nd date for the review of this program.
Okay, motion by Commissioner Perush. Is there a second? Second by Commissioner Hunt. Discussion? Pretty simple, just setting a date right now. We'll make a determination at a later date. All right, I'll call for the vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Motion passes. All right, so City Engineer Donahue, you're going to notify the property owners that this is a potential and that they should come to the hearings, voice their opinions and all of that good stuff, notify them.
Yes, that's correct.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, that brings us to item 10, the approval of the DTE master agreement for municipal lighting, light emitting diode, street light conversion.
I'll actually start that.
Are you going to start that one, Mr. Bray?
So, okay. So it's an ongoing effort at implementing the ARPA program. We have been working with DTE, as indicated in the staff report, that we have a little over 3,000 lights. 2,219 to be exact, are under the ownership of DTE. These lights are reaching their obsolescence and need to be replaced. There's certainly a financial incentive to implement this program. With the rate increases that DTE is proposing, if we do nothing, the costs associated with those lights are over $900,000 annually. The cost of converting is a little less than $500,000, and the payback is less than a year's time. So I commend the staff. When we had the conversation the other night, sustainability is in the works with DPS, so I did not want to diminish the hard work that's being done by our facilities and other folks that have that expertise, that they're putting that into place. But I just wanted to highlight this would authorize us to enter into the master agreement to conduct this program. If you have very specific questions, Mr. Exley is here, and the if you want him to explain light emitting diodes or mercury vapor lights, all those fun things that are associated with street lighting. But this is a project financially makes sense to implement. And again, we already have the funds set aside through the ARPA program.
Thank you for shedding some light on that, Mr. Brake. Questions? Yeah. Commissioner Cullo.
I'm sorry, I'm just in the jargon. How long?
Here we go.
It's a shorter agenda. We got to get in somehow. Mr. Breaker, Ms. Exley, how long will this take to complete? Is there a timeline?
If I talk with DTE, So whenever I talk with DTE, they want to be done by the end of September. Okay. If we get everything signed today, moving forward end of September, we're looking good.
Okay. So this will be an aggressive program that the city will see immediate benefit to this too.
Yeah, that's great, especially before it starts getting darker when the lights are on the most.
And more importantly, the visual brightness that's associated with that. All right, not to continue on the puns, but there's a night and day difference.
Oh, man.
Go ahead.
Sorry.
I guess my last question here, Mr. Leal, have you had a chance to review the contract?
Yes, I have.
Okay. And approved, I've seen that.
And it's horrible.
Don't do it.
Yes, and it's the same as a previous one that's come before the commission. Okay. With no issues.
Right. Any motions? Commissioner Prush?
I'll move approval of this resolution.
Seconds? Second by Commissioner Cobo. All right, discussion? All right, it's a good program. Excited to see this get done. And with some cooperation with DTE, other areas, we don't necessarily have good cooperation with them, with tree trimming and some other issues in the city, but this is one we do have some good cooperation. So I'll call for the vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Motion passes. All right. Let's go save some money. This brings us to boards, commissions, committees review, crime prevention council. I see Ms. Barkman is there. Just hot seat real quick. All right. Went so fast tonight.
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. So as you may recall from our previous workshops, this particular item has been discussed, but in our last workshop, we were under the time of trying to get you into the regular session on time. And I didn't feel like we had really kind of fully rounded out that discussion of what that new board should be. And so, as I mentioned during that meeting, I'm back again this evening to finish out that conversation regarding that particular board. So because it's been a few weeks, I'm just going to kind of recap some of the things I've heard. So for you, the original recommendation came in to sunset the Crime Prevention Council, and then you guys were interested in pursuing a new board that would be a to-be-determined, fully named, but for now I'm calling it the Community Engagement or Community Support Board. That's where we're going. And so this would be a new board that would kind of move some of the functions of crime prevention under our community engagement coordinator to be managed through the city manager's office. Some of the things that got mentioned last time in our brief discussion around this were that this board would act on behalf of the city and attend neighborhood groups meetings, that it would help us develop and implement new neighborhood groups, and some people talked about community engagement, which is a little bit different than neighborhood engagement in my mind, and wanting to do more community engagement events and help Judy or Ms. Davids implement the different events that she would be moving forward with from a community engagement perspective. So some of the neighborhood programs in the parks and things like that. Some of the other pieces were to help community groups navigate awareness of city issues and resources, assisting folks to resolve neighborhood issues or disputes, and assisting in creating programs and advertising of the block party permit. So what I kind of wanted to hone in a little bit on tonight was a little bit of the difference between neighborhood engagement and community engagement in my mind. Neighborhood engagement traditionally has been very place-based to a specific geographic area, whereas community engagement in my mind speaks a little bit more broadly, and it can include neighborhood groups, but it can also include the places that are not place-specific, where people find community, whether that is through a religious organization. We have different kids go to different schools that may or may not be in their neighborhood, so sometimes they end up in those types of community group rather than more of a neighborhood one. Some people find their own identities or political affiliations create community in different ways than maybe we haven't always seen in the past. And as in my experience, more neighborhood groups are going away than are being started. And so some communities have started to switch that philosophy away from neighborhood engagement into a broader community engagement. That doesn't mean you can't do neighborhood engagement. It doesn't mean you can't send somebody to be at the neighborhood meeting or help work with neighborhoods and that want to start groups, but it is a little bit more broad. And so I'm trying to kind of figure out what exactly you guys are looking for in this group, what you want to see them work on or do, and if there's anything else that as we move forward in kind of drafting the ordinance or resolution that creates this body, is there anything else you all think I need to consider?
I think your analysis on the fact that community has many different shapes and forms and placements and definitions is really interesting. I think what I took away last time was, you know, we say the Crime Prevention Council, that was very specific. I think over the last 20 years with modernized policing technology, ring doorbells, you know, Facebook, you know, who is this person? Well, you know, that's, you know, we know that person, they're just out selling cookies or something, you know. I think that for me, we have an incredibly talented group of people that have done some pretty good things in the community over the years. And the question is, how do we use them within that same vein of, instead of negative crime prevention, you know, do we look at it in terms of like safe and healthy neighborhoods? Because I think today's problems in the neighborhoods aren't, you know, people going around and, you know, vandalizing mailboxes and burglarizing houses. Yes, that happens, and, you know, we usually nip it in the bud really quickly with our professional police force and awesome detectives, but we have folks that are more lonely than ever. We just heard the Surgeon General come out and talk about loneliness. We have an aging population where folks are, You know, I have neighbors now that I can't believe, you know, we used to see them out every single day, and it's just kind of a recognition, like, we don't see them on these sunny days as much anymore. So how do we engage and have the tools and the smarts, and, you know, for those that want to help and stay engaged in their neighborhoods, and where that neighborhood is the neighborhood, or it's a community center they belong to, or a religious institution. So for me, I think we have a whole set of problems that, you know, we're never going to see solved at the federal and state level, but I think here, with the love we have in this community, we can find a way to channel it with some very talented people. I don't know what that means in terms of 10 bullet points as far as what people do, but I have a vision that there's some things we can solve, and we need help identifying those things, and we need people to help solve them. We'll go with Commissioner Hunt, and then Commissioner Douglas.
Yeah, to sort of piggyback on what you're stating, Mr. Mayor, when this ordinance was drafted, crime prevention and, like you said, community policing would look completely different from what is necessary today. So the committee that that performed the functions under that ordinance wouldn't necessarily need to perform those functions today. But I am a bit concerned with everything you're trying to put under the umbrella of this new committee. It sounds as if the Crime Prevention Committee or Council would be sunsetted, and this entirely new committee would be started. When we spoke last, it was my understanding that this would be a committee that continued on doing the crime prevention work that it's doing now, planning the events, the block party, and looking to get out into the community and provide safe neighborhoods, not necessarily assisting Ms. Davids in other social type events. And I believe that's what, at least with the community or the committee members that are currently on this board, envisioned as well. So it was my understanding that, you know, it may be expanded a little bit, it may be changed a little bit, but not necessarily including all of the bullet points that you just enumerated. That was just my thought from what I, you know, recalled from our last conversation.
I preceded Commissioner Hunt serving as the city's commission's representative on the Crime Prevention Council. And it's a very active group, and they actually do the work of the committee. This is not an advisory board that tells staff what to do. They do the work. And so I'm confident that people who are that eager to serve will find a niche in a reimagined body. But my question would be, I'm going to turn this back to staff and say, what need is not being met right now? I mean, setting aside the label of crime prevention and talking about neighborhood engagement or community engagement, what does the city need? And not Ms. Davids there, Ms. Barkman, Mr. Brake. I mean, where is there a gap that a group of volunteers would be qualified and to do and interested in doing it? And I'm not necessarily asking that you answer that right now. It does feel like there are needs, but I think they need to be articulated before we start, you know, recreating a group. And I want to be careful that we don't get a group that just tells Ms. Davids what to do, because Ms. Davids' plate is already really full, and she's a professional, and she creates her own work plan, addresses our strategic plans in her job. And so I want to make sure that when we convene a committee in this capacity, we do it so we're meeting a real need in the city.
Anybody on this side? Commissioner Perush?
I would have to agree with Commissioner Hunt that I don't want to see the crime prevention aspect and work of this committee go away and be replaced by something else. Clearly, the role of the committee and what was envisioned when this committee was created a very long time ago has changed over time, because the whole field of community policing and neighborhood engagement and policing has changed over time as well. But I think that's still a very essential component, and I think it's important to have committee people or community people, not just city employees or staff, involved in those kinds of activities, because you can't have effective crime prevention and safety within the community without having the community engaged as a whole. So I don't want to lose that aspect of it. But on the other hand, I think that there's a lot of opportunities there for the people that are already involved to expand their roles, to do more community engagement, which will have an indirect effect on the whole crime prevention aspect of it anyway, just because there will be more community activities, there will be more interconnections with people, people who want to understand the various aspects of the community better, and so it will all work together. There's some synergy there. So I agree with Commissioner Hunt that I don't want to lose the whole community policing aspect of what this group has done over time, but I can see some benefit in using their energy to expand that to include other kinds of activities that could be helpful to the community and reinforce the community engagement that we all want to maintain somehow. So I don't know exactly what that is. My guess is that the committee itself will have some ideas as to where they could be most useful in being community engagers, so to speak, and help out with Ms. David's efforts and all the rest of our efforts. So I think that perhaps we go back to them and say, okay, we're going to expand this a little bit. It's not just neighborhood crime prevention anymore. We're going to try to expand it a little bit. What are your thoughts in terms of how you do that most effectively?
Commissioner Pello?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So the last time we talked about this, I'm looking at my notes, and I wrote down, entire commission, let's keep this committee and refocus it. Let's adjust this to building neighborhood associations. I think that is kind of what everyone here is saying. It's the crime prevention of a neighborhood association. It's a person knowing the people on your street, the community engagement. So I think at this point, what we're really, and you know, to echo Commissioner Douglas and the mayor, I think we're just looking for solutions at this point. I think we're at the point where, you know, we've kind of given the direction of, hey, let's hear some ideas, but we really need the professional opinions. You know, you all went to school for this. We just sit here every other week, right? But we need your professional opinion to really know how to dig down into this and make sure that we're doing it right, and that you know, we don't want that smorgasbord, right? Like Commissioner Hunt said, no one can possibly do all those activities. So I think the next step of this is really looking for what staff envisions this commission could be, with our input. I've talked about this about five times now. You know, where we can really go and take in, as Commissioner Perucci said, this is probably a conversation to have with the Crime Prevention Council as they sit right now. Although they'll probably have great ideas, you know, they can be workshopped there to really come to a solid idea of you know, a good understanding of where this commission started, where it is now, and where we can go in the future. But I don't think that's anything that really necessarily will get workshopped at this table, so to say.
I'd also like to understand too, and I won't put Chief Moore on the spot, but I think the police department can be part of that recommendation and dialogue as well, as they absorb everything we're saying up here. I mean, nobody knows, you know, has a better daily pulse on the community than the folks that are having to respond to crisis, emergencies, burglaries, crimes, and even our fire department as well, you know. And I think that, you know, we talk about crime, I just think that, you know, safety should be part of that as well. And when we talk about safety, I think it can get really, really broad. But it would be interesting to know what the Crime Prevention Council can do, leverage their experience and have their thoughts to say, okay, yeah, we can trim back on some of these things. They're not the most effective use of our time that we've been working on, or modify them. And we think we can do some of these things that will really help, you know, deliver on some of the other important elements of community that, you know, are safe. If nobody knows that you're living in a house and that you're in harm's way, that's more tragic than somebody breaking into my car and stealing my loose change, you know? So we don't want to expand it to be like the Solve All of Society's Ills committee. That's not.
Is that available?
Yeah, for a price though. You can't afford it. But I do think that it would be interesting to get a little feedback from them, maybe back. I know you've been talking to them, and maybe with a little bit of the police input as well. Because there's some assists you need to keep as well, right? I mean, there are like neighborhood watch things and stuff like that that are, I mean, with the advent of technology, with Ring doorbell, I mean, all these things. I shouldn't be advocating for Ring. There's so many people that make them, but it's kind of like Kleenex now. I think there's some things too. We want to make sure that the PD says, yep, we got to keep doing these things, because if we stop, it will be a loss. And then I think we look at the other bucket and say, hey guys, do you want to reinvent these other buckets a little bit to, you know, really meet the needs of today? And if not, that's okay too, but it'd be good to hear their input on it. And with the leadership of Commissioner Hunt, I think we can get there serving on the committee. Yes, Commissioner Douglas?
Yeah, I just want to pick up on something that Ms. Markman said about neighborhood associations. It's in our strategic plan, our work plan, to reinvent neighborhood associations. I feel like that is a huge lift, requiring a lot of staff to organize and put together bylaws and convene meetings. And the will does not seem to be there among people in the neighborhoods. So unless we have a clear need and strategic plan for how we're going to use neighborhood associations, and I haven't heard that so far, I'm disinclined to support initiatives where we try to gin up neighborhood associations where none exist.
Ms. Parkman.
Thank you. That was one of my concerns about having this be a more focused neighborhood body. Having done neighborhood and being the person, the staff person who had to attend neighborhood groups that were not mine all the time, I'm usually the youngest person there by a long shot. I've seen more go away than more start. And it doesn't mean that we can't find ways to say, if a group does want to do this, we can help you. But where I'm hesitant, because I've done this, I'm hesitant to say that a staff person is going to be the person who's going to schedule your rooms and handle your agendas and craft your bylaws and things like that. You tend to want to stay out of the interpolitics of that neighborhood group, because it sometimes creates factions and the city can't take part on a neighborhood thing. Sometimes that really creates more problems and more staff resources that are required for some of those things. So we can look at how we can support those. I think there is a path forward, and I've been trying to clear some time on my plate with Ms. Davids to help craft what we could do with neighborhood groups that we do have. And where we can fill in some little plugs to help support them, because I think they are important when they exist, if we can help them. But we can't force people to join a neighborhood group.
Right.
And
mm-hmm.
they don't want to.
Mr. Mayor. I appreciate that. But one thing too, and gosh, you know, Commissioner Douglas, I'm surprised to hear you say that about neighborhood associations, because in the aging in place plan, goal 5.1b includes reinvigorating neighborhood associations. I mean, we're just trying to achieve the goals that you all did a great job laying out for seniors here, right? Like, this is part of that plan. So we got to make sure that, you know, as we're looking to improve the community, this is one way that we can do that. So I do hope that we don't get too far away from that, because there is a new era of a neighborhood association. It's definitely not what it was in the 40s and 50s and 60s, perhaps. But they do exist. They're digital. They're online. The millennials are on Facebook. The youngins are on TikTok or whatever they're using today to keep track of each other, right? So there are ways that we have different neighborhoods, and what our definition of community is different. So it might not be the traditional, come over for tea and crumpets and we'll talk about our neighborhood. But there are neighborhoods that get together. So I think it is a good way to give them toolkits on how to do that.
I think we're a little focused on the literal neighborhood association geographical boundary.
Yeah.
I like what Ms. Markman said. It's like, maybe that's part of the solution. Maybe, you know, that can be a model in some cases, or it looks different. I do agree, the city, it's hard for us to be involved in any of it, because, you know, you may have a neighborhood association that's petitioning against something. You know what I mean? And I don't want to have any sort of city influence. I want that to be an honest, genuine conversation between the neighbors and the city commission, not have a staff member on there influencing things. That's just not how this operates. So, but having the tools to say, hey, if you want to start an association, this is what it looks like, this is what you can do. A little less motivated these days, not to get all dark and dreary, but, you know, we have attention spans of gnats, and, you know, younger people are, and all people seem to be overworked and overconsumed, and, you know, when they do have downtime, they go down the social media holes and, you know, on the internet and TV. I sound like I'm 95 years old right now, but, you know, there's a lot of issues out there that we can't solve, and we can't bring people together. But we can do things like, hey, maybe there's some, you know, in this neighborhood, we put out a few barbecues and, you know, inflatables, and we just let people opt into what they want to know about, tell them what's going on in their neighborhood, what's, you know, coming down the pike with road changes or whatever. It might be kind of a fun thing to do. And, you know, that's not a neighborhood association, but it is a fun thing to do. People will come out. It's amazing. Yep. Free popcorn and, you know, those blow-up bounce houses, they come out in droves. You know, you send them a letter, they're building something down the street, three people come sometimes, you know, not always. So I think that, you know, I'd like to give that flexibility to the board and experiment and see what works and just, you know, generically say engagement. You know, there's things that we need to keep people safe and to prevent crime, but there's also things we need to do to prevent people from, you know, from other things, you know, that fit with our goals, like aging in place and, you know, making sure that neighborhoods are stronger. And, you know, it might just be one person at a time, but I'd like to see this board experiment, think about some ideas, and not put them, combine them to a box. That's me.
So I think that was the conclusion of the 10 minutes of conversation I needed at the end of the workshop to get a direction of where you guys were hoping this would go, so we can kind of put some parameters and work with the board to shape what the new elements may look like and how that will be supported through staff.
Yeah, we'd be happy to join anything, you know, the next Crime Prevention Council meeting. You know, invite some commissioners if that works too.
Tomorrow evening.
Smiley, I got planning.
So not about crime prevention. We do have a handful of other committees left here, right?
Yes, we do.
Okay. Do you plan to bring those at one point? You know, like tonight was a slow meeting. Are you going to pick another slow meeting and maybe get those all done at once?
So the direction I received from the body was to bring these one at a time on a slow night. So if that has changed for you, let me know. Otherwise, you won't see me next week for this item. I can't remember if I have something else. But probably in June-ish, we would be looking at the next one.
Mm-hmm. So maybe my colleagues agree, if it's a rather easy, the great work of the city has been completed early on in the night, like a night like tonight, maybe look at the agenda. The city management can determine if maybe we can knock out two or three of them at once, depending on what the agenda looks like.
Yeah. Leave it to staff discretion.
Okay.
I do think at some point there's going to be an up or down vote on the existence of this commission, this committee. Not tonight, we're not a full body, but I mean, I think it's going to come to that at some point.
Yeah.
And, sorry, do you?
Go ahead, Ms. Barkman.
With that being said, I understand it's your intent not to fully diminish this, but this was created through a resolution. And we may look at whether or not to do it as a resolution or an ordinance. So you may, in fact, see a repeal of something and then a placement of something, but the intent will reflect what you all have shared with me.
Sure. Commissioner Bruce?
Just one thing, that I think the committee could consider is not only the broader aspects of what they think they should be doing, but also the name. I mean, maybe it's appropriate to change the name and move it away from just Crime Prevention Council, which seems pretty narrow, to a broader, and you probably don't want to put in the Community Engagement Committee because that's too broad, but maybe they could consider some name changes as well to kind of redefine their focus a little bit just by the naming aspect of it.
Mm-hmm. That's all I have.
Okay.
Is there anything else? Clear as mud.
All right. Well, I'm glad we cleared up all the confusion and made everything so much easier for you, Ms. Barkman.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right. That brings us to the last agenda item tonight, which is the appointment of the interim city attorney. I see Mr. Leal is on this and Mr. Bray.
Mm-hmm.
Brock, paper, scissors.
All right, I get the short straw. So I'm very pleased to recommend to you the selection of Nick Grochowski as the interim city attorney, as the impending departure of Mr. Leal is upon us. So presenting that to you for your consideration this evening. Happy to answer any questions, and Nick is in the audience. So if you want him to come up and make a quick introduction or if there's any other information. So with that, hand that off to Mr. Leal.
I just wanted to add that when Nick first started with the city, some of the commissioners had asked me individually about Nick and his background, and I had indicated to them that Nick was a very accomplished municipal attorney who had a broad municipal skill set to offer the city, and we were blessed to have somebody of his caliber join our community. I also said that, you know, he would be one of the goals that I've had that I learned from a mentor years ago was always engage in succession planning, because especially as we enter those years when health issues start to arise in ourselves, that it's always great, you know, you look forward to have somebody who can actually step in the event something happens to the director or the city attorney. And then that candidate I found, and actually I should say the team found Nick Grochowski. I'm fully confident in his ability to be able to run the office and to be able to do the work that is necessary as your interim city attorney. And in fact, he's already reached a tentative agreement with Attorney Rob Morad to come in and do the prosecution work so that there will not be a drop off in the performance of the office. So with that, I strongly recommend Nick as an interim city attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Leal. Commissioner Perush?
I had the opportunity to meet Mr. Grochowski at the last Charter Review Committee meeting, and that was a couple of weeks ago. That was his first meeting with the Charter Review Committee, and it was a very, very, very effective meeting. He worked very, very effectively with the rest of the board. We got a lot accomplished. We got a lot more accomplished than we'd accomplished in many months beforehand, because it was able to direct our discussion and keep us moving in a direction that was appropriate for us at this point in time. It was very clear to us as we went through the discussion of various aspects of the charter that he has a very broad municipal background in terms of municipal law, which is becoming more and more a specialty these days. Not only in terms of charter issues, but ordinances and municipal functions within the charter and so on and so forth. Very experienced, very knowledgeable. So we're very comfortable working with him, and we look forward to working with him on a going forward basis, whether it's him or whether it's someone else that he appoints from the office. I think we're going to be in great hands with him as an interim city attorney. So I'm delighted that he's willing to do this. It's sometimes a thankless job, as we all know, but I'm delighted that he's willing to do it. So we should have an opportunity to say hello to him this evening, but prelude to that, I will move approval of this resolution appointing him as interim, effective June 19th.
We have a motion by Commissioner Perush. Is there a second? Second by Commissioner Hunt. All right, discussion. Commissioner Hunt.
In addition to all that Commissioner Perush just stated, the fact that Mr. Grochowski, I'm saying correct, I apologize if I'm not, although has been with the city of Royal Oak for a short period of time, knows our city, and he knows our charter, our ordinances, our bylaws, all of, you know, those great things that someone would have to learn coming in. Understanding this is an interim position, I think there's no better person to lead our legal team than someone who knows our legal team and our city. So,
very good point. Yeah, I'll just add, I've had the opportunity to work a couple times on Planning Commission with Mr. Grochowski, and he's given excellent counsel. We're all amateurs, mostly, on the Planning Commission. We're not lawyers, and his ability thus far to, you know, understand the questions, boil it down to things that we could understand, I was already impressed out of the gate. Looks like three of the people up here that have law degrees already are very comfortable with this as well. But just as a layman, you know, a numbers guy, I can see, you know, that he'll represent the city very, very well. And he'll hit the ground running, to Commissioner Hunt's point of view. You know, we have a lot of things on our plate here in the city. We're a growing, vibrant, you know, constantly adapting to the environment around us city. And it's a hard task to jump in to this, as Mr. Leal knows, to jump into this sort of dynamic city. So I think bringing people up from within is the right thing to do, and I hope he grows into the full-time position as well. I'll call for the vote, and then I'm going to ask Nick to come up here and make sure everyone knows he's not too shy and say a few things. All right, I'll call for the vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? All right, we have an interim city attorney. Congratulations, or maybe, maybe not. No, I'm kidding.
Thank you, Mayor. Good evening, Mayor, Commissioners. You know, I'm very humbled and honored by the support and comments. Not having been here that long, it's really is an honor to be a part of this city and have your support and consideration for this position. And I really welcome the opportunity and look forward to working with all of you, collaborating to continue to make Royal Oak such a dynamic and vibrant city and help make the transition as smooth as possible. I know I can hit the ground running, and hopefully that will translate into a very smooth transition for the city and this commission moving forward.
Wonderful.
So thank you very much for your support and the kind words. Really appreciate it.
All right. Well, we're grateful for your willingness and acceptance to step up to the plate in a time of need here, and look forward to working with you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Nick. All right. Unless there's an unlucky agenda item 13, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I think it's lights out on this meeting.
Oh, lights out. Oh, geez.
It's a callback.
Yeah. I bet you just took the electricity out of the room with that on. So.
I take a dim view of all of this.
Let's not get dark, okay?
We have a motion by Commissioner Cola. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Douglas. Discussion on this motion? Finally, some light at the end of the tunnel. We'll call for the vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Motion passes. We're adjourned.